Hey, if you got Bibles, open up to Luke chapter 20. We're going to continue in our study of the book of Luke. We have Bibles in the back in case you ever forget yours. Grab one, follow along with us, because we do, as a church, teach through the Bible, verse by verse, line by line. As you know, we're teaching right now through the book of Luke, the life of Jesus Christ. I entitled this, What is Truth? Because at the end of his life, which we'll get there, Pontius Pilate looked at Jesus and asked, what is truth? And so if ever there's an answer to that question, it's Jesus Christ. Yeah, that's new. Ever stop and ask yourself, why am I doing this? Not pastoring, but I've been drinking this tea, three cups of this, and it's horrible. But I've had three coffee cups of this, and that's probably why my mouth is all sticky. Luke 20, let's get in. We're gonna look for a moment, and I want you to ponder and think of all the questions that Jesus was asked from the beginning. Think of all the times he was asked questions. If you stop and look at the word, and there's only four biographies of Jesus, Matthew, Mark, Luke, John. We need all four because each one of them has a different perspective. But from the very beginning, if you look back and look at the first question ever asked him, it was from his parents. They had came when he was 12 to the temple, to Jerusalem, for one of those high and holy days, Passover. And as they were leaving, going back in that big caravan that people would always travel in for safety's sake, the Bible tells us that they looked around and they couldn't find Jesus, their son. So they hightail it back to the temple, to Jerusalem, and there he is. And the first question ever asked Jesus in Luke 2, verse 48, son, Mary asks, why have you treated us like this? Your father and I have been anxiously searching for you. Jesus said, of course, what's up? I'm in my father's house. Where else do you think I'd be, right? Luke 4:34 records the second question. When he was in Capernaum, he went to the synagogue and there was a man possessed by a demon. And the question from that evil spirit for Jesus was, Luke 4:34, ha! I always start off my questions like that. Ha! What do you want with us, Jesus of Nazareth? Have you come to destroy us? I know who you are. Here, from the demons themselves, you are the Holy One of who? Holy One of God. And you know, as you look through the rest of the questions, and there's a lot of them, probably the most important, in my opinion, at least one of the most important questions ever asked Jesus came, if you look at Luke chapter 18, verse 18, from a man we call in the word the rich young ruler, because he was wealthy, the Bible says he was young, and he was a ruler. And so he asked Jesus, good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life? The question that we ask today would be the same. How do we get to heaven, right? What do you have to do to get to heaven, people in this world ask today. It was asked Jesus. If ever there was a question you wanted an answer to, it would be that. Amen? Well, as we come to the end of his life now in Luke chapter 20, we know he was asked many things by the religious leaders as well. But the truth was, as you look at these questions, they weren't honest ones, were they? I mean, we all know an honest question, and we've all been asked dishonest questions. And we know that when it comes to these questions, Jesus wasn't asked these in order to find out answers. Ultimately, he was asked these questions by religious leaders to trip him up, to trap him, to get him arrested and ultimately crucified, killed. So one of them, Luke 20, verse 2, we looked at it last week, or a couple of weeks ago, when he cleaned out the temple. Remember, he was asked by the religious leaders, by what authority are you doing these things? In other words, who gives you the right to come in here and turn over these tables and run all these people out and the animals out? This was our racket. What are you ruining it for? And then Luke 20, verse 22, in order to trap him last week, we looked at it. Is it right for us to pay taxes to Caesar or not? And the answer was, render to Caesar the things that are Caesar's and to God the things that are God's. He affirmed the place of Rome for all that they provided Israel, and he affirmed who God was. And then as we saw last week, the Sadducees asked him about marriage, and they asked him about the resurrection. And on the end of that question, Luke 20:40 tells us, after he answered that, no one dared to ask him any more questions. Stop for a moment and think about that statement. You may not realize this, but in all in his life, Jesus was asked 183 questions. And all the time, from beginning to end. Now, it says that no one dared ask him any more questions. And what we can infer from that is dishonest ones. Because as we finish the rest of his life, he's going to be asked many more questions by the religious leaders as he's being tried in those five kangaroo court trials that he was in. And ultimately, as the title of this sermon would suggest, or this series would suggest, Pontius would ask him one more question as well. What is truth? But Luke says no one dared ask him any more questions, and we can interpret that to mean dishonest ones to trap him, dishonest ones to get him arrested. And you got to imagine, after so many questions, and then more importantly, so many perfect and truthful responses, astounding answers to those questions, you got to realize that these guys probably came to the place where they said to themselves, who is this guy? Right? I mean, just alone, render to Caesar the things that are Caesar's and to God the things that are... I mean, just alone right there, it says they were astonished at his words. Now, they didn't say it out loud, but I think inside it was screaming out, who is this guy? How does he do this? We've seemingly got him, and yet he always gets away. And that's why I love what Jesus does next. Instead of being asked a question, Jesus goes on to ask his own question. Truth be known, folks, Jesus asked 307 questions of people himself. He was asked 183, and he asked his own questions 307 times of people. And here's one of the most powerful questions Jesus asks. Verse 41 of Luke 20. Then Jesus said to them, how is it that they say the Christ is the son of David? David himself, Jesus goes on, David himself declares in the book of Psalms, the Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand until I make your enemies a footstool for your feet. Jesus goes on, David calls him the Messiah, Lord. How can he be his son? Now stop. The reason for this question was simple. Because the religious leaders thought they had Jesus pegged. They thought they totally figured out what he was all about in terms of the trouble he was there to cause. Because according to them, the religious leaders, Jesus was a troublemaker, wasn't he? I mean, they said as much. They saw him as a loose cannon, somebody who needed to be reeled in, somebody who needed to be dealt with, and ultimately somebody who needed to be eradicated, right? Who needed to be crucified. They saw him as somebody who was leading people astray. Remember when he was walking with his disciples and they were picking grain on the Sabbath? And of course, the religious leaders thought that he was telling his guys over and over to break the Sabbath. I mean, who cares about God's law? But that's not what Jesus was doing. They saw him as leading people astray. But hear this, folks. They saw him as a loose cannon. They saw him as leading people astray, but I think the biggest problem they saw in Jesus, what they thought of him was that he was a false prophet, somebody who didn't truly speak for God. That's how they saw him. And you know what the punishment for being a false prophet was in the Old Testament, according to the Jews? You would be stoned, not Colorado style. You would be stoned with rocks and killed. That's what would happen, and so they saw him as a false prophet. They ultimately didn't think that he came from God. They didn't think he represented God. They didn't think that he spoke for God, and they didn't even think that Jesus knew who their God was, and that's why Jesus goes to Psalm 110. That's where he quotes from right here, and that's why this quote for them was so stupefying. I like that word. Jesus realized, as he quotes from Psalm 110, he quoted from the Old Testament often. It's a tragedy sometimes when I hear good people, people that I know and love, say, you know what, the Old Testament, I think it's a waste of time. I don't even see what the value is in the Old Testament. It's old, and it's been replaced by the new. So what's the point of the Old Testament? But folks, do you know that in the New Testament, there are 855 Old Testament quotes, scriptures, in the New Testament. 855 times the writers in the New Testament, as they were being inspired by the Holy Spirit, went back and quoted the Old. Now, there's got to be value to that, because the reality is the New Testament and the gospel is built upon the Old Testament and Judaism. Realize that? I mean, it's the roots of it. And not just 855 quotes of the Old and the New, but Jesus quoted from the Old Testament himself 36 times. So here he is, the Son of God, right? The Son of Man. And he quotes 36 times from the Old Testament. He quoted 7 times from the book of Exodus. He quoted 8 times from the book of Isaiah, the prophet. He quoted 10 times from the book of Deuteronomy. Realize, when he was combating Satan in the wilderness, the only book that he quoted from was the book of Deuteronomy. And so that was a powerful book for Jesus in his defense against the lies of the enemy. And then, as we see here, Jesus quoted from the book of Psalms, 150 of them. He quoted 11 times from the book of Psalms. And what he says here in Psalm 110 is essentially this. He says the Christ, the Messiah, the one that they were looking for, is said to be the son of David, which means that he would be a descendant of David. That's what they saw. The Messiah would descend from the line of David. And not only that, but as a descendant of David, he would be called a son of David, and as such, he would be somewhat inferior to David, because David was their man, and he would descend from David. But Jesus does something. He goes back and he tells them in Psalm 110, and he shows them that David himself said that the promised Messiah was his Lord. Now, it might not sound like much, but what Jesus was doing was forcing the religious leaders to see that the scriptures taught that the Son of David, the Messiah, was also the Son of God, read that, God in the flesh. Now, they thought they knew who the Messiah would be, a descendant of David. And they thought he would be somebody who would come in and establish Israel again and throw off the Roman oppression. They thought they had it all figured out. Folks, practically speaking, Jesus here was claiming, I'm not who you think I am. He claimed to be the Messiah. They knew that. And I want you to think of all those questions, 183 of them, and they still didn't know who he really was. And ironically, at his trial to have him killed, they asked him, the religious leaders did, outright, are you then the Son of God? I mean, Jesus claimed to be the Messiah, but what he's saying is the Messiah is not just a descendant of David. The Messiah is the Lord of David. He's also the Son of God, God in the flesh. Jesus was claiming, guys, I'm no normal man, even though you think you've got me pegged. And now look at what he says about the religious leaders. It all ties together. We'll get there. Verse 45, as we continue. While all the people were listening, Jesus said to his disciples, beware of the teachers of the law. Beware means watch out. Be on your guard, right? I tell my daughters all the time, beware of boys, right? I'm kidding. No, I'm not. Watch out. Be on your guard. They, the religious leaders, the teachers of the law, like to walk around, Jesus tells his disciples, in flowing robes and love to be greeted in the marketplaces and have the most important seats in the synagogues and the places of honor at banquets. I mean, you see some guys who are puffed up, who like their position and like all the accolades and the honor that are along with those positions. And Jesus says, they devour widows' houses, and for a show make lengthy prayers. Such men will be punished most severely. Well, I've heard it said that I'm so hungry I could eat a horse, but I'm so hungry I could eat a house? Never heard that one before. What does it mean, they devour widows' houses? When these itinerant preachers, rabbis, would go around to different villages and towns, they would be hosted by oftentimes people and oftentimes even widows. And as the host, they would provide for them a place to stay. As the host, they would provide for them meals and food and an ability to shower or clean up or whatever. They would take care of their needs, and it was all free of charge. But that's all they were supposed to do. Unfortunately, what the rabbis went on to teach is, it's not enough that you just provide a place for us. It's not enough that you just provide a meal for us as we come, but it's more important that you raise money for us, because how else are we going to be provided for? And so it became this very difficult thing. And oftentimes it was the widows that ultimately would be forced to provide and raise money, because they oftentimes had the ability to host in their homes. And Jesus looks and says, these guys devour widows' houses. And for a show, they make lengthy prayers. Such men, he says, will be punished most severely. And I want you to stop and think about what he's saying. He's saying that these religious leaders were not the way they were supposed to be. They weren't normal leaders. And we all think, what's the word normal, right? Well, think about leaders today. There are a lot of different kind of leaders today. We know there are strong leaders. You might think of someone that has been a strong leader in your life. We know sometimes there are weak leaders. We know there are humble leaders, and there are prideful leaders. Sometimes we've served under selfish leaders, and sometimes we've served under demanding leaders. This might describe your boss, I have no idea. There are arrogant leaders, and probably one of the most tragic is there are incompetent leaders. Can anybody relate to that kind of list, right? If you've ever served under any kind of leader like that or boss like that, you know what I'm talking about. And according to Jesus, the religious leaders that the people were supposed to be being led by, unfortunately, were being taken advantage of by. And it's sad because they were supposed to be leading people to God. They were supposed to be pointing people to the heart of God. And they were supposed to be serving the people. What did Jesus himself say about his own leadership style? There's no way you can look at the Gospels and the life that he lived and not remember the words that he said when he said, the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and give his life a ransom for many. And then when he was talking to his disciples about what it meant to be a leader, not like the ones who lorded over, what did he say to them? The same thing, right? The greatest among you, or the one that's going to be the greatest, will be the least and be the servant. Jesus totally turned things upside down, and that's how he led. And folks, he claims that the religious leaders, just as Jesus was no normal man, he says these guys are not normal or good leaders as well. Now stop for a moment and think of what that applies to us. Oftentimes we're told as Christians that we're not supposed to judge each other. We're not supposed to look at each other and disagree. You shouldn't say that about that person. But Jesus is flat out telling his guys, be on your guard. Do you realize the Greek word judge is literally the Greek word krinos, which means to examine. And we're told to examine one another. We're told to inspect our own life, and we're told to inspect the fruit from other Christians in our lives, not to condemn them, that's God's place, but to examine. And if as leaders we see somebody, or maybe you're a leader yourself, then the challenge for you is to stop and ask, why do you lead? What's the heart in your leadership? Is it the heart of Jesus to serve? Or is it the heart like these leaders had to take all that you can get and make it all about you, the selfishness, the pride, oh, I love the position and I love. Or is the heart of a leader, according to Jesus, to give himself away, to give herself away, to be a servant? You see, I believe this, folks, it's important to discern and to evaluate the kind of leaders that we are in the capacities that we have. And this applies to you as a boss. This applies to you as a manager. This applies to you as a mother. This applies to you as a father as we seek to lead our children. This applies to me as a pastor. This applies to us in so many different ways. What kind of leader, how are we leading? And then it applies to asking the question, what kind of leaders are we following? You have a right to examine the leaders that you're following. In fact, you have a need to examine those that are over you in whatever capacity they are for me. And the evaluation, according to Jesus, in his words, is that leaders serve others and put others first. That we realize you aren't here for us, but we are here for... That's huge. We're here to give ourselves away. We're here to love on people, and it's not just about me. This is leadership in general. Everything these guys weren't doing. They failed at that kind of leadership, and Jesus points it out. And then he goes on. Look at verse 1 of Luke 21 as we continue. Just after saying these words about these religious leaders, it says he looked up. Now remember, he's in the temple. He's teaching. And as he looked up, Jesus saw the rich putting their gift into the temple treasury. And it says he also saw a poor widow put in two very small copper coins. Read that into the same temple treasury. The temple treasury was the name for the place in the temple where there were 13 horn trumpet-shaped giving boxes. They were in the shape of a trumpet, and you can read that as a horn or a trumpet. They open up at the top, and people will go along and put their gifts into those treasury, those temple trumpet offering boxes. And those offering boxes would have inscriptions on them. One said, for the poor. Others said, for example, for the incense. And so the money that would give them would raise the money for the incense, or for the poor, or all the different necessities of the temple. And people gave. And so Jesus stops, and it says he sees the rich giving, and he sees a poor widow who put in two very small, some of your versions would say a mite or two mites, right? It's 1/40th of a penny. It's literally nothing. In fact, the minimum according to the law that you could give in the temple was two mites. And that's exactly the minimum that she was able to give. And here's what Jesus says. He deduces what's going on. And in verse 3, he says, I tell you the truth. This poor widow has put in more than all the others. Read that, all the rich that were putting in their gifts. He says, all these people, verse 4, gave their gifts out of their what? Out of their wealth, out of their abundance. In other words, it didn't really cost that much. You know, they had so much money, and here's some of it for God. But she, Jesus contrasts, out of her poverty, put in all she had to live on. Folks, widows in that day were in a tough place. They didn't have welfare like we think of today. Now, the New Testament, the Gospels, even the book of James, James says true religion is to look after what? Orphans and... So there's a place for that in the New Testament, but the Old Testament was more tough. In fact, when a husband was gone, think the book of Ruth, it was very hard for a widow to get by. And so she had just a little bit, and she gave it. And why is that important? Some commentators look at this and say, well, that's kind of out of place. You know, next week we're going to look at signs of the end of the age as Jesus continues to teach an amazing study about his second coming. We'll look at that next week, and that's what he goes on to say. So what's this whole thing about the widow couched right in here about the Son of David? And now it's like, but it has everything to do with the contrast of the religious leaders. Because their selfish, me-first attitude, it prevailed. And everything they did was for appearance's sake. And Jesus, for a moment, he shines a spotlight on the selfless and giving heart of a poor widow. And no doubt, in context, she was probably one of the widows that these religious leaders took advantage of, right? He just talked about them devouring widows' houses. Maybe she was one of them. And according to the Lord, what she gave was more than all the others, the rich, combined. In fact, this, according to Jewish law, as I said, was the smallest acceptable offering a person could give or offer. But it was the largest offering given that day because it was all she had. And so Jesus, for a quick moment, gives us a short teaching on giving, on what that's all about. And much is said about tithes and offerings in church today. A lot is said about how it is that we should give and how much we should give. I've heard some churches require X amount of giving, 20%, at least 10%, in order to go to that church. It's a requirement. I won't say any names. That's not my point. I mean, I've been in ministry for 20 years. I've heard a lot of different stuff. Some people, it comes right out of their checks. They have no choice to give. And always when I hear those kind of things, I hear people walk out of churches vowing never to come back because all they ever talk about is money. I'm not going back to that place. All they ever talk about is money. And that's all those churches, all those pastors want is our money. I love the fact that we don't even take an offering. We don't even pass the plates. Not that it's not needed, and I'll talk about that in a minute, but because I love the fact that it's not guilt-giving. Like, oh, what do I got in here? Here comes the plate, you know? Oh, there we go. No, it's between you and the Lord. The box is in their back. If you want to give, that's between you and the Lord. But here's what we do at Vista. We teach through the Bible, verse by verse, line by line. And so when giving comes up in the Word, like it does today, I'm going to teach on it. So I'm going to share with you a few quick things about giving. And if you want to get mad about it, that's between you and the Lord. Because here's what God's Word says. Jesus spoke more about money than heaven and hell combined. You may not realize that. He talked a lot about heaven. He talked a lot about hell. But Jesus talked more about money than heaven and hell combined. Let me give you a few powerful statements he made about money. In Luke 12, verse 34, Jesus says, "For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also." What does that mean? Wherever your treasure is, there your heart is. Read that, wherever your heart is, there your treasure is. It's about who you are. That's what you care about. Luke 16, 13, Jesus says, "You cannot serve both God and what?" You cannot have two masters, Jesus said. And for many people, money is their master. It's easy to do in this world where everything requires money, right? Other statements about money in God's word, not from Jesus, but equally as powerful. Paul said in 2 Corinthians 9, 6, "Remember this," he wrote to the Corinthian church, "whoever sows sparingly will also," what? "Reap sparingly. And whoever sows generously will also reap generously." Jesus is not teaching Paul is not teaching a lesson on farming. Paul is talking about the heart that you have in giving. How much you give or how much you don't give. And then one of my favorites, Paul to Timothy says in 1 Timothy 6:10, "For the love of money is a root of all kinds of" what? Love of money is a root of all kinds of evil. Oftentimes we hear this misquoted. People will say money is the root of all kinds of evil. But folks, that's not what the Bible says. Money is also the way that you're going to put food on the table, right? It's the way that you're going to provide for your family. So money, in and of itself, is not evil at all. It's innocuous. It's inert. It doesn't have. But what we do with that and how we see that, if we love it, and you stop and think about, here we are, 2017. You think about so many of the ills, so many of the sins, so many of the tragedies they're committed, and all the stuff that's driven by profit, and all the stuff that's driven by shareholders, and all the stuff that companies will do and take advantage of. I mean, if you watch the news for any length of time, you can definitely attest to the fact that the love of money is a root of all kinds of evil. And throughout the world, people are absolutely put down and have a hard time because of the love of people, or the love that people have for money. And that really, folks, is the one thing that plagued the religious leaders more than anything else. They didn't truly love God, according to Jesus. They didn't truly love people, according to Jesus. They didn't truly serve the people the way that Jesus felt like they should. But instead, the religious leaders loved themselves, as he says. They loved their high position and their authority, which is why they wanted to get rid of Jesus, because he was threatening that. And they most definitely loved their stuff, their money. And that's why I believe Jesus calls attention to this widow and the gift that she gave that was so powerful. Jesus claims he was no normal man. Jesus claims these were not good or normal leaders. And here what Jesus points out is a gift that was no normal gift. Because it wasn't about how much she gave. It was nothing. It was about the heart that she had when she gave it. Because she loved her God so much and came and gave all that she could give because that was the heart that she had for her God. Amen? I mean, what does that mean for us? Because when it comes to us, as I look at it over the years, I see some people give out of duty. Now realize here at Vista, as we don't take an offering, I also don't know how much anybody gives. I choose not to know that information. And so when stuff is given at the box, stuff is given at the Vanco or online, at the kiosk, Jan, our accountant, deals with all of that stuff because I want to see people all the same. I don't want to see somebody for a dollar sign. I want to love and serve no matter how much you give here at Vista. So just know that. But the reality is I do know some people, as I hear them talk, they give grudgingly. Oh, I'm supposed to do this, so I'm going to do this. I mean, my own heart probably over the years has been there at some times. Some people give out of duty. Some people give half-heartedly. And then and realize this, many people don't give anything at all. You know, there's grudgingly, half-heartedly, out of duty, or nothing at all. But folks, never forget this as we give. Ultimately, God sees our hearts. Ultimately, God knows, which is why from the beginning we've chosen to make 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 7, our statement for giving. It's on our information, it's on our bulletins, it's on our website, because I believe the Bible teaches this. Each man, Paul writes, each woman, each person should give what he or she has decided in their heart to give, not reluctantly or under what? Compulsion, grudgingly, duty. For God loves what kind of giver? God loves a cheerful giver. I mean, that's the heart that's the widow's heart, right? You got those two mites. She's digging in there. What do I have? I said, oh, yeah. Oh, wow. Okay. Here you go, God. Jesus didn't despise it. Jesus didn't look and say, that's not going to do anything. Oh, look at all that. Jesus said, that is the heart that blessed God. You see, it's not just about how much money we give. Giving in the heart is the realization that our lives belong to Him. Amen? All that we have is His. All that we are is His. We belong to Him. In fact, when we say that Jesus is the Lord of our life, when we pray Jesus is the Lord of our life, when we accept Him as the Lord of our life, what that means is our life is submitted and belongs to Him. Do with it what you want. I'm here for you, God. Use my life. A pastor friend used to say that we're a penny in God's pocket and He can spend it anytime. Maybe we're a mite in God's pocket and He can spend it anytime, any way He wants. That's the heart that God is looking for in giving. And it's not just money, it's time. Because some people may not, like this widow, have a lot of money, but some people might have a lot of time that they can give and serve at church or wherever they are, nonprofits and such. Some people have a lot of talent, and so they can use that talent and the gifts that they have to build up the body of Christ, whatever way that is. And it's not just here at your church. It's all over the place. And then the third is some people have treasure. We pastors like three things in threes: time, talent, treasure, right? So there it is. But it's the heart that we have to give it. And that's what it means when we say Jesus is the Lord of our life. So what does this say to us? Not a normal man, not normal leaders, and not a normal gift. And bottom line, folks, we as Christians aren't called to live a normal life as followers of Jesus Christ. He's not just a good man, Jesus. He wasn't just a good teacher or a powerful leader. He wasn't just a powerful or good role model. We are following Jesus Christ, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And as such, if He is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords in the world and in our life, then that So as Christians, we are submitting our lives to the one who was and is the truth, which means that makes a difference in how we live and what we stand for. It should affect every area of our life, not just how much we give. But, you know, one of the things, if we submit our lives to the truth, as I close, it's all the truth. One of the truthful statements that we know in the Word, Jesus said, is to love one another. But you know how many times I hear Christians who love the Lord, I hear them say, I hate that person, or I hate this individual. The people that God told us we should love one another, and by our love they will know us. By your love they'll know that we're Christians. I don't think it's any place for us to ever say we hate anybody, do you? Now, there might be things that we disagree with somebody, but I don't think it's ever a place that we can say I hate an individual. And sometimes I hear people say, when we're told in the Word to forgive one another. I mean, this is what it means to submit all of our life to the Lord. If we're called to love one another, do we? If we're called to forgive one another, and the Bible says we are, you know how many times as a pastor I've heard people say, well, I'll never forgive that person for that. That was just too much. I'll never be able to forgive, and I have no desire to forgive. And they hold on to that bitterness or that anger. They're not submitting their lives to the truth of God's Word, are they? I hear people say, well, what I have is mine. The Bible says, don't store up for yourself treasures in heaven or on the earth. Store up for yourself treasures in heaven where moth and rust will not destroy, right? But I hear people say, that's my stuff. And all of us are forced to ask, how much of God's Word are we submitting our lives to? How much of the truth of Jesus Christ are we submitting our life to? Because the bottom line is, we're called to be givers. We're called to love. We're called to forgive. We're called, as followers of Jesus Christ, to submit all of our lives to Him. Amen?